A very good morning, everybody who's joined us live on Facebook. It is an extreme honor to have with us Dr. Anand Gokani, our mentor and guest for today.
Good morning to all of you. Good morning.
A very good morning to all the students, members, and to Amrita ma'am. We are here today to hear a very interesting session from Dr. Anand Gokani, sir. I am not in any capacity to introduce a person like let me just take quick 2 minutes to introduce you to our audiences. Dr. Anand Gokani, sir, is a renowned diabetologist based in Mumbai and practicing at Bombay Hospital. The great-grandson of Mahatma Gandhi, his shift from being a doctor who spends long clinical hours dispensing medicines to one that prioritizes prevention measures, stress management sessions, and week-long workshops is inspirational. He felt the need to be more proactive to stem the exponential rise the number of patients getting diagnosed with diabetes and its root cause of stress. And hence, he began taking stress management classes for a group of corporate employees. I think, thank God for us, that he realized that the root cause happens at a very early age. And he decided that it was time to take children into an experimental setup and where them into an ashram back in the year 1999. From then on, these workshops have turned out to be a proven formula and that he continues to carry out for the colleges in Mumbai. We are absolutely honored to have him as our mentor over the years, and our students have been benefiting with his camps, workshops, and sessions at our school. A very, very a big gratitude to you for being present with us today, and we are eagerly waiting for your session.
Thank you very much, Sugandha. I sometimes, when I listen to you speak about me, I sometimes wonder whether it's me or is someone behind me that you're speaking with. It's very kind of you to say all these kind words, but let me tell you that the joy is more profound on my side to be with so many children and so many teachers where my heart actually lies. My profession may be medicine, but my passion is children. And therefore, any opportunity I get to be with them is a gift to me, rather than my giving my time to them is as being a gift to them. So, children, a very warm welcome to this Zoom meeting. I have been given a subject which is very non-medical, but it has medicine has its roots in this subject. The subject given is very esoterically phrased, from faith to fulfillment. And it stems from a talk that I gave recently, which maybe some of you have seen. And that talk was a little autobiographical lecture given on TED. And it brought out a lot of thoughts in me while I was preparing for it. And I'm going to share some of those thoughts, because those thoughts go into reams of paper. So talking about y'all today, The 12th standard is right on the threshold of school. Threshold meaning the point which separates you from your home or from your secure, comfortable, and cushy life, from the external world, wherein there is a lot of sunshine, both physical and emotional. And there is a lot of insecurity, a lot of adventure, and for which you have to be prepared. And the years you spend in school are spent in preparing you for that adventure. When you're in school, you feel very often that I want to get out of school. I want independence. I want freedom. But you don't realize that with freedom come responsibilities, comes the insecurities of everyday life, and comes the struggle, sometimes only for existence and sometimes to achieve what we want to achieve. And I know for sure that when we have met in our camps and I've interacted with all of you, I see so much brightness in all of you, so much originality, so much genuine passion, that I feel that it would be a waste to humanity if you didn't tap it the right way. And that's the reason why I like to take these seminars or these meetings, is to help you with whatever little experience I have, to be able to achieve the best that you can achieve. Coming to achievement, it's very important to know that to achieve something in life, you have to have certain equipment. At this point, I'd like to ask you, if you were given a choice in your life, that if you have to navigate your life, you need two instruments. And which two instruments would you choose at this juncture, at this 12th standard juncture, to guide you through your life in the most successful way? I'd like to ask this question of the audience. Let's hear any one or two answers. Anybody coming up with an answer?
Student, this is an interactive session. So please unmute yourself and you can answer them.
Sir, I would probably choose optimism and hard work at this point.
Optimism and hard work are abstract nouns. Suppose I ask you for absolute tangible instruments, two instruments. I agree, optimism and hard work will feature in this talk. And you're very correct in saying that. But if I were to ask you for two instruments, like you want a knife and fork, or you want a glass and cup and saucer, like this, two instruments which would help you to navigate your life to the ultimate success. I want you to think out of the box. It's not an easy question. This is a question that flummoxes even executives in multinational firms who are supposed to be very smart people. But if you give me the answer, I'd say you're head and shoulders above them. Even if you gave me the function of those two instruments, I'd say you're fantastic. What are the two things you need to achieve big? Anybody else?
I would say paper and pen.
Not bad, but you will need to write on that the actual two instruments which you need. Paper and pen is the means, not the end. I want the end.
So I would want a coin and a clock.
Coin and?
I'm just doing some dumb shit.
Say it again.
And a clock.
Clock. You got it half right. Fantastic, Disha. You got it half right. The other half.
Doesn't she look like that model, Courtney?
Disha, other half? I'm not telling you which half is correct. Okay, I'll tell you, clock is correct. Anyone else? Okay, I think it's early morning blues. We warm up a bit slowly. Let's get on with our talk. Disha said very correctly, we need clock. And to complete the picture, you need a compass. You need a clock and a compass. And this sees you through. And I'll show you how. So when we are sitting at this point in our lives, 12th standard, waiting to complete one major phase in our life and move on to another phase, we have to have certain qualities. We need to have, you know, amongst, you know, I'll tell you, for example, when you go on a journey or you go out, you want to protect yourself from the various influences. So when you sit on a motorcycle, you want a helmet. The helmet protects you from injury. You want to go in an aircraft, you want a life jacket. They always tell you that if the life jacket is under your seat and in case you need it, you must use it. So we know the security that there is a life jacket. And likewise, if you go out in the rains, as it has been raining torrentially, you'd like to have an umbrella. Now, these are things that help you through all the physical vagaries in your life. You may go through so many of these kind of physical vagaries where we have something to protect us. But what happens when we go through emotional vagaries in life? And when we go through the life's problems, which are presented every moment of the day, not one problem a day, 100 problems an hour. How do we then maintain ourselves to circumvent these problems and come out winners? We need one very strong ingredient, and that is faith. We need faith in ourselves. We need faith in life. We need faith in God. Now, faith is something that is a very abstract thing. And that's the thing which we lose when we are at most distressed. You know, when you have someone in your family who is very sick and you go to a hospital, you go with faith. Then the doctor is not that indoctrinated in how to speak to you. He comes up to you and says that, look, I'm sorry, your relative has a very serious disease and the case is hopeless. Whenever I hear that phrase, hopeless, I say there is nothing in this world that can be hopeless, because hope is something that has not happened and therefore you cannot predict it. You cannot predict what will be tomorrow. Tomorrow may be a dark night, tomorrow may be a bright sunshine, bright day, and we don't know today what it's going to be tomorrow. And hope is what lives in tomorrow. And therefore, hope can never be hope. There can never be a hopeless situation. But for hope to take root in your heart and to know that nothing in this world is hopeless, you have to have faith that I can move mountains, I can conquer, I can succeed, and I can be happy. So, having said these words as a preamble, I'd like to get on to our main talk. What are the instruments we need to succeed in life? Because you will have come on my camps, some of you. During my camps, I spend every moment trying to teach you something. I try to tell you many things which are useful to you in your lives. Many things you may remember. Many things you laughed at then and may use later in life. And many things which I learned from you. I'm going to go over some things again. So pardon my repetition, but I think that they are relevant to be repeated any number of times. And every time you hear it, you learn something else. That's what happens to me. Every time I say it, I learn something else. And so let's look at the two things that we need. Today, when you sit down and think, maybe after this talk, you spend half an hour by yourself and think, what am I doing with my life? So far, school was great. Fifth standard became sixth. Sixth standard became eight, seventh. Seventh became eight. Eight, nine, 10, 11, now 12. And suddenly, 12th standard becomes something I don't know. And that insecurity hits you sometimes in the 10th standard, sometimes in the 11th, sometimes in the 12th. It's not an insecurity, it's an apprehension. An apprehension as to what is going to become of my life. And that apprehension can be allayed if you planned yourself well. So if you have to plan yourself well, I told you, you need a compass and a clock. The compass tells you which direction to go. And the clock tells you how much time you have to reach there. So let's look at the compass. First thing is, I would ask you, have you got a goal in life? Have you made a goal for yourself? Because you're walking every day. Every day that passes, you're making progress. But is that progress going in circles? Are you going round and round in the same spot? Or are you moving forwards? Many a times we look at life and we say, I want to become this. Like someone in the, like, let me take my example for a starter. When I was in the seventh standard, I used to read a lot of books. From the seventh standard, I started reading a lot of books. Before that, I used to read, but they were not profound books. So when I started reading, I picked up various kinds of novels. In that, I read a medical novel, Final Diagnosis by Arthur Haley. And once I started reading it, I started resonating with it. I started feeling that I am in the pages of that book. And I didn't want that book to end. I would eat that book for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, so to speak. I finished it, I read it again. And I felt lost in that world of that book. Years went, months went, and I started reading more, and I found another book called The Citadel by he was a doctor, A.J. Cronin. That is also a medical book, and that is written by a doctor. After reading that book, I was sure that this is my calling and this is what I want. So I decided in the seventh standard, late in the seventh standard, that I'm going to do medicine. My father from a business family, and business passed down from great grandfather, grandfather, father, obviously would come down to me. So when I told my father I want to do medicine, he thought it's a joke. He said, no, the eldest son of a family must do business. But in my mind, I decided that no, my passion says no medicine. This is where I'm comfortable. Business is not where I'm comfortable. My father thought it was a passing phase. And he thought that, okay, he'll grow out of it. Ninth standard, let him do science. After science, he'll take commerce. In the ninth standard, we had an aptitude test. And I was so determined to do medicine that I engineered the entire aptitude test. Sticking mark, we had some 1,000 choices to make of different professions or different activities that we want to do. And so I tick marked everything that was remotely related to medicine. And fortunately, I got a report back saying aptitude good for science in bracket medicine. I showed it to my father and I said, see, this is my aptitude and let me take medicine. He still had hopes. I went through my ninth standard into science. I got into science faculty. We went on to do science in 11th standard. In our times, 11th standard was graduation. I finished with science. I got into inter-science, which was equivalent to your plus two stage, 10 plus two plus three, the plus three stage. In that, the second year is the inter-science. And so I got into a situation where the next step was to get into medicine. That's when my father realized that this guy is sure he is not going to change his mind. And then he helped me along the way, got into medical college. Then I was keen to become a doctor. So I trained hard for 4.5 years and life went on. And today I sit before you as a consultant in a field of diabetes, which is a part of general medicine. And I practice so many other things which are also related to medicine. So this was an example of how I set myself goals. I set myself the goal of becoming a doctor. Then I set myself a goal of passing the aptitude test, getting into the science faculty, getting into inter-science, getting into medical college. And every year had a shift in my goals and I achieved the goal and I set a new goal. So the system is that you have to sit now. And it's not going to happen after a year or 2 years or 3 years. You have to sit now and set yourself a long-term goal. And then you set yourself short-term goals. But every short-term goal is a step towards your long-term goal. And therefore, it's very important today that you set yourself a long-term goal. I have many student friends, many students who I deal with. And many of them in the 12th standard will tell me, I asked them, I said, what are you going to do next? Sir, I've applied to universities in the United States of America. So I said, which faculty? So I'm taking liberal arts. I said, liberal arts, what is that? So he said, sir, we can choose any subject every semester. And we can taste the waters of every river, so to speak. Every river means every subject. So I can do sociology, I can do French, I can do German, I can do economics. I can combine economics with statistics, or I can combine economics with biology. I want to taste all that. So I said, okay, you taste all that. After that, what? He said, then I'll decide, which is by the time they'll be 22. Then I'll decide what I want to do. I said, you haven't already decided? He said, no, you've not already decided. Then I asked them, when will you decide? He said, I'll first try all these subjects and then I'll decide. And many of them, after trying all those subjects, spending 2 years in America, having a ball of a time, away from supervision, away from any parental influence, they come back to India or they try and do something there They do something they're not interested in. And many of them come back here and join their father's business for sheer want of anything better to do. And those people in life, after seeing 62 years of life, I can tell you that not one of them has achieved anything big. At the most, they hold on to what they have, but in most cases, they lose what they have also. But they have so much that it doesn't push them on the road. The next generation may get onto the road. And therefore, I again re-emphasize, re-underscore the fact that you need to make a goal in your lives. You need to sit down and make a goal. I don't say you can't change your goal. You can change your goal every year. But you need a goal because you need a purpose to walk. When you walk, you have to have somewhere to walk to. You don't just get up in the morning and say, Mom, I'm leaving home, and just walk. If it takes you to Kiani Bakery, good. If it takes you to Elpro School, good. If it takes you to the river, good. If it takes you somewhere else, good. If it takes you nowhere, good. That's not how you lead your life. It leads you, you lead a life with purpose. Only a purposeful life gets written about, gets talked about, gets celebrated. So we need to fix goals. And the first thing is to fix a long-term goal. The long-term goal is, let's say, I want to be an engineer. Let's say I want to do science. I want to invent a cure for COVID. You can discover a cure for COVID. It may be sitting in your backyard because most major things were done by accident. You remember how Marie Curie discovered penicillin? They were investigating something else, not penicillin, radium. And she washed it and found in the sink in the dark, it was glowing. And that's how she found that this is radioactivity. So even accidentally, so many other discoveries were made. No discovery was made with purpose. It was made by accident. But that accident had a whole lifetime of purpose. That I want to go into science, I want to do this, I want to do arts, I want to do economics, I want to do social service. You may want that. I met somebody who said, can you find me somebody who's got a trust, who's a doctor? I don't mean trust as in trustworthy. I'm saying as trust as in a group of people wanting to do something good. He said, can you find me a trust or a doctor who's willing to dedicate his life to run a to build and run a hospital? Because I think it's time that I put all my money into that. And I want to do something to give back to the city. Because they've earned a lot of money. So I said, that's a huge goal. And that goal, every step will need planning. And every step will lead us towards that goal. Till one day, that goal will bring succor to millions of people. You can have a goal like that. You can see what the felt needs around you are. And accordingly, decide what you want to do. So once you set your long-term goal, you start setting short-term goals, which lead you to the long-term goal. Now, when you do this goal setting, you have to have a certain system. How do you fix your goal? That how is a very big question. It's a very important thing. Your father says, I think I want you to be a doctor because I am a doctor and I want you to sit in my office. It's the same as doing your father's business. It's not what you want to do. Remember one thing, children. You are born with a certain purpose. You were created for a unique purpose. You are not a carbon copy of XY. You are not a Xerox copy of your classmates. You are unique. Like, for example, Dhwani Garg is unique. She has a characteristic of her own. There are no two Dhwani Gargs in this world who are same. Their name may be same, but their characteristics are not same. Neither Tia Mishra, same. There are no duplicates. So don't try to be someone else. Don't try to please someone else. Try to please yourself. And therefore, it's very important that you think and see where does my passion lie. That is your most important thing in your life, your passion. If your profession becomes your passion, you will succeed like nobody else. But if your profession becomes something which is somebody else's passion, then you will drag on and never succeed. Therefore, it's important for you to address this question, what is my passion? After you've addressed your passion, you have to prioritize. Because unless you have a set of priorities, you will lose time in all the jumbo mumbo that surrounds you. You know, I always said to myself, I'll do this after my routine is over. And the routine takes, in one day, I finish 9 out of 10 things. One thing gets postponed for tomorrow. Tomorrow has its own 10 things. And that routine never finishes. And in my life, I realized suddenly that I have reached 62 and I have not addressed what I really want to do. So I said, now I want to do it. And then comes the biggest pitfall. What do I want to do? I want to run a 100-meter race. Today, I have the knowledge how to do it. I have the know-how how to plan it. But I don't have the physical ability to do it. I tried doing it. I'll tell you, as recent as last week, I went down to walk. I said to myself, on 31st of August, I'm going to run my personal half marathon. I haven't done any athletics for years, except to play casual games with kids. But I have not actually run. So I first doubted whether I'd be able to run. So I said, let me start walking. And I started walking and I walked about 50 minutes, then 1 hour, then 1.5 hours, then 2 hours, then 2.5 hours. And the max I walked was 12 kilometers. And I still had energy to go on, but I got called up for dinner. So when I started walking, I suddenly realized that I am now getting better and better. So I started jogging. And then one day, in the same park where I walk, there was a 10-year-old girl who was running by herself. And she was so beautiful in her running, so easy and so graceful. I said, let me test myself. So whilst I was having a light banter with her, I told her, I said, come, I'll race you for 30 meters. So she said, okay, come. So he said, on your marks, get set. And I set off. I took the first 3 steps at full speed. And suddenly I felt a click in the back of my calf. And I felt a muscle tear. And I had to stop. I didn't finish 30 meters. And then I limped back home without letting anyone know what happened to me. And I came home and I said, if I can't run 30 meters, where's the question of running 21 kilometers? I said, it's not going to be easy. The muscles today are not as flexible as they were in my youth. Today, they have become plastic. If I stress them, they break. They don't stretch. And so I'll have the whole uphill task of making them elastic first, which means training for longer than I need to or I imagined, and then also not maybe able to make it. And then I said, I always wanted to run a marathon, but I'll do it after, and after the list of afters was so long. So if you want to do something like this, do it today. You want to climb Mount Everest, don't wait till you're retired and then say, I want to climb, but I can't. That day will come. And therefore, prioritize what you want to do. Address your passion and then prioritize. I have told this story to some people in your class. And I'm going to repeat it in brief for those who didn't come on my camps. There is a story of prioritizing. And that story is very important. Remember every word of it. It will see you through life. This is a philosophy class. And on one day, the philosophy professor came in with 3 boxes and a jar. The jar was like one of your snack boxes at home, the snack jars where you store snacks or food items. He placed the jar on the table, opened one box and took out golf balls. You all know the size of a golf ball is about like a table tennis ball. And he took out these golf balls and started putting them into the jar and filled the jar to the brim with golf balls. And he told this class, he says, is it full? And the class said, yes, it's full. Then he opened the second box and in that there were pebbles. And he proceeded to put the pebbles which went and arranged themselves between the golf balls in that jar. And he emptied the entire box of pebbles into that jar. And they also fit in. And he said, now is it full? So everyone started smiling and said, yes, sir, it's full. Then he opened a box of sand and he poured the sand in and the sand fit in between the pebbles and the golf balls. And it became completely full. All the sand also was accommodated in the jar. And now the class was in splits of laughter and everyone says, sir, now it's full. And then the man takes out 2 cups of coffee and he pours them into this and the coffee gets absorbed into the sand and in between the spaces. And he put 2 cups of coffee also inside that. And now everyone was in splits. And then he said, okay, I haven't spoken a word so far. I'm going to explain to you what this all is all about. And this is what you listen to. If you consider the jar, however big it is still limited. It has a shape and it doesn't go beyond that shape. That jar is your life. That jar represents your life. The golf balls are those that represent your most important things in your life. That is your family, your parents, your brother, sister, and your children, your spouse. Then it represents your friends, your close friends for whom you should give your life for. Then it represents your health. Your health is so important that it's the biggest wealth that you have. And fourth, it represents your passion. These are the golf balls of your life. If you put them into your jar first, you put your friends, your family, your siblings, your children, your spouse, your passion, your health as a priority, all will fit into your life. Then the small pebbles are the kind of jewelry you own, the amount of money you have in your bank, the house you live in, the car you drive, the clothes you wear, and all those material happinesses that you collect over your lifetime. Those are the pebbles. They also can fit into the jar. Then comes the sand, which movie you saw, which drama you went to, which place you traveled to, and what you did on a day-to-day basis, which was enjoyable, but not material, not of any importance. That also will fit in. So he said, it's very important for the order you place your things into your jar. You put your golf balls first, the pebbles next, and the sand last. And you will find that all three will fit in. But you put the sand first. It settles at the bottom. Then you put the pebbles, they settle on top. They can't go between the sand. And then only one or two of the golf balls will fit. They can't get into the jar after that. So it's very important to have the right order. Because if you don't have the right order, you don't fit everything in. And that's why priority is important. Then there was one bright spark like Ananya. Ananya? Yep. She may want to know, what are the 2 cups of coffee doing in that jar? You want to know? Ananya, I'm looking to you. Ananya Singh. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Somebody asked, what is the 2 cups of coffee? The 2 cups of coffee is philosophy again. It is no matter how busy your life is, no matter how packed your life is with all your passions and your health and your children, family, wealth, job, everything, you still have time to have a cup of coffee with a dear friend. You have to take out that time. And that is the full crux of this priority story. It's very important that we know all this order, because if you know this order, you get the best of everything. And if you don't know this order, you miss out on the important things, because the important things can't be accommodated after unimportant things have taken precedence. So we need to learn how to prioritize. After prioritizing and making your goals, after planning, you need to review, and that's when the clock comes. If you have done your prioritizing well, you get your clock in next, because everything you do is measured against time. You know, there's a very, how many of you like, you like music, and maybe you have listened to Pink Floyd. Pink Floyd is a my generation pop music company. Band, I would say. But they had a philosophical twist to their music. If you have not already listen to it. Go on YouTube and go on Pink Floyd. They have written 2 beautiful songs. One is Money, one is Time. I'll tell you a few lines. I don't claim to remember them perfectly, but the lines that struck me, I remember. The first line starts, the song starts with a play of alarm clocks. About 100 alarm clocks going off in different tunes. And that's the noise you wake up to. All of us in different houses wake up to an alarm clock. It may be a mental alarm clock, maybe real alarm clock, but alarm clocks. So time song starts with the jangle of alarm clocks. And then they start singing. And he said, ticking away the moments that make up a dull day. Ticking away the moments that make up a dull day, which means you're passing the time of a dull day. Every moment you're passing, because the day is dull, you don't achieve anything. Ticking away the moments that make up a dull day, fritter and waste the hours in an offhand way. Means don't know what you're doing. Kicking around on a piece of ground in your hometown. Can you imagine someone standing at the bus stop, looks at a piece of stone on the floor and kicks it. And he just kicks it, but in his mind, what is going on? In his mind, he thinks that he is an international football player and he's just kicked a goal. But actually, he just kicked a piece of stone on the floor, which has not gone anywhere purposeful. And this is what we do with our lives many times. Kicking away the moments that make up a dull day, fritter and waste the hours in an offhand way, kicking around on a piece of ground in your hometown, waiting for someone or something to show you the way. You're waiting for someone to come and say, hey, listen, this is not how you do it. You do it this way. But no one is interested because they themselves don't know. And therefore, it becomes very important for you to know. Now, this song goes on with some more lyrics added, till in the end it says, he said, you're looking at the sun going down. Now it's at the end of your life. You're looking at the sun going down. This is the sun. The sun is going down only to race around you and come up behind you again. You know, it goes around the earth and comes up behind you again from east to west. You see it going down in the west. You're still facing the west. Next day behind you in the east, the sun has come up again. And suddenly you realize that time is going. So he says, you see the setting sun and say, you run to catch up with the sun, but it's sinking. Only to race around you and come up behind you again. Then he says, everything's the same in a relative way. Every new day is the same in a relative way. But you're older one day. And he says, everything's the same in a relative way, but you're older, shorter of breath. And one day closer to death. And this is the reality of the whole song. And when you listen to the song and you dissect the meaning of the lyrics, it's a wake-up call. It tells you, yes, it's true. First, you didn't have shortness of breath when you ran up the steps. Then you start feeling shortness of breath when you reach the fourth floor. And then the third, and then the second, and then even when you're at rest. And this is the whole progression of life. And therefore, it becomes very important for you to know that time is something that is abundant at your age, but it is still limited. It is not unending. And therefore, don't say, I am going to do it tomorrow. I'm going to do it day after. You don't know how much time you have. You don't know how much time is left. Therefore, every moment gifted to you becomes a very important moment. It must be packed. That takes me to Rudyard Kipling's very beautiful lines. He wrote a full poem, which is instruction from father to son or daughter. Read it. Read each line carefully and understand it. If you read it in a hurry, it sounds just like jargon. The last lines. If you pack each unforgiving minute with 60 seconds of distance run. Means each minute has 60 seconds and each second you show you have done something. If you pack each unforgiving minute with 60 seconds of distance run, then and only then will you be a man, my son. This is written for his son, but it applies today equally to the daughter also. And therefore, it's very important to realize these two lines, that why unforgiving minute? Because each minute once gone will never come back. You're holding sand in your hands, and this sand is slipping slowly through your fingers. And every day you say, I've got so much sand in my hand. but suddenly realize that half the sand has gone and you don't have anything to account for it. And therefore, it becomes very important for you to be able to account for every minute of your life. And that's why this kind of planning is very important, where your time is always at your beck and call, and you're not being sidelined by the passage of time. So the clock and the compass gives you direction, true north. What is your true north? Your passion is your true north. And what is the clock? Clock is telling you how fast you will reach true north and how fast you will walk in that direction. That's why, figuratively speaking, it's very important that you have a clock and a compass. So we've done the prioritize. We've done each step, planned, reoriented. What are the ingredients you need for success? Now, I have addressed this question to myself many times. What are the ingredients you need for success? And that's where I come back to what one of the girls said right in the beginning. You need hard work and optimism. Optimism, yes, you always need optimism to be positive. Positive is to be hopeful. Hope will come when you have faith. So we come back to faith. Now from faith, if you have to reach fulfillment, if you have to fulfill your dreams, you need certain ingredients. And these ingredients are very difficult. Once you ingrain them in your body, you will realize that you are in your body, mind, soul, spirit, whatever you want to call it, you will realize it makes you different from everyone else. You will not remain run of the mill. And you will be different. And to be different is to become lonely. To become lonely can sometimes be unnerving because you feel that I'm the only one who's doing this. But remember that when you want to succeed, you're sitting in a triangle, and that triangle has a base. At the base, there's a huge crowd. As you move up a little bit, there's lesser crowd. As you move up, it's even lesser. And when you reach the final apex, you're all alone. Don't be afraid of loneliness, because success comes only with loneliness. It is not loneliness, it's aloneness. Loneliness is the desire for other company. Aloneness is conquering your own loneliness. And therefore, it becomes very important that you don't subscribe to what the herd does. You do what you think is right. And for that, you need three qualities. One is hard work. Hard work is so difficult because it makes you go against the grain of your evil fabric. Your body's fabric is evil. It is controlled by the devil. And it says, relax one more hour in bed. Life is long and you can do so many things. Relax, don't worry. But once you start relaxing, sloth sets in. As your sloth sets in, you stop wanting to do anything, and soon you find that you're only doing time pass. And time pass is the worst crime you can do, because once you pass the time, it's over, it's gone, never come back. So you have to fight against the current every day by hard work. And that hard work should be in the direction of your goal. So in the course of your hard work, you will get punished, you will get pain, you will get anguish, you will get anger. Everything will happen to you, but you have to stick to it. Because in the end, it is the one who worked hard who gets venerated and worshipped. He is the one who makes it to the headlines. He is the one who makes happiness. And then he has happiness right through his life without hard work. Because the fruits of hard work, as they say, the roots of education are bitter, but the fruits of education are sweet. And so now you're in the roots of education. Nurture the roots, they're bitter. But as you go up in life, you will reach a point where your fruits of education will be so sweet, and you sit back and enjoy while you see the others. You all know the story of the ant and the grasshopper. The grasshopper fiddled when youth was there, summer was there, bright sunshine, and the ant was carrying laboriously food to store in its ant hill. And then came winter, and suddenly grasshopper has no business and is found on the streets, hungry, tired, and washed out. And the ant is sitting with peace and lots of enjoyment in his absolutely abundant ant hill. So decide today you want to be ant or grasshopper. You be a grasshopper, waste your youth in doing all unnecessary things. And if you are an ant, you work so hard that your foundation is rock solid and then stand proud all your life. So that's about how you plan your life, first with hard work, second with honesty. The honesty is so important. I'll tell you the example of the Akbar and Birbal story. I know many of you know it, but I'm going to go over it again. One day, Akbar asked Birbal, how many honest people are there in the city of Delhi? Delhi being the capital of a very great country called India. And Birbal said, sir, I need a day to find out how to do it. I can't really assess. Then he got a bright spark idea and he said, your lordship, can you dig a well, can you dig a swimming pool in the backyard of your palace? And I'll show you how many people are honest. So a swimming pool was very laboriously built and lined, very beautiful swimming pool for the Badshah. And the people were told in the city of Delhi that our Badshah is a very unique man. He doesn't swim in water. He swims in milk because he's so royal. And therefore, each person in the city of Delhi will come in the pitch dark of night and pour a glass of milk into the swimming pool as his contribution to his king. So the appointed hour was on Amavasya night, where there was no moon, pitch dark. The entire town, all the men lined up with a glass in their hands, came and quietly poured their glass into the swimming pool and went away. In the morning, Akbar and Birbal standing on the balcony, overviewing the swimming pool, and anxious to see what is inside, Akbar saw, and to his dismay, he found the swimming pool filled with water. And why? Because every man in that town thought, who is going to see what I am pouring? If I pour water and everyone pours milk, my water will be lost. No one will know the difference. Why should I waste my glass of milk? Every man thought like that. And in the morning, every man got caught out to be a dishonest man. So that brings me to two words, reputation and character. You have both are very familiar with both these words, reputation and character. I ask the meaning to many people. I don't know if we have the time here to ask what you think is the meaning, but I will give it to you straight anyway. Reputation is what you are when the lights are on, when everyone can see in front of everybody. And character is what you are when the lights are off, when no one can see. And the most successful people in this world have the same reputation and character. If your character and reputation can fit into each other perfectly, you have nothing in this world to fear. But if your character is different and your reputation is different, you rest assured that one day the reputation will lead to the blackness of the character. And you see that in every so-called successful person who was once brought to book by the administration and then insulted, and his final days of his life were spent in complete ignominy with hatred in everyone's heart towards those people. You take a name of at least 100 people like that who enjoyed a lot of wealth, a lot of power, a lot of fame, but when it came to the end, they remembered only for their misdeeds. And because their reputation and their character were two different things, a face to show the world and a face which actually belonged to you. And therefore, children, it's very important that you synchronize both these, because ultimately, this above all, to thine own self be true. You have to be true to yourself. So honesty is a policy that you should never forgive, never forgo. Initially, it feels very uncomfortable. Honesty, to be truthful first time, is a very painful thing. But to be a liar is a painful thing for a whole life, because you have to keep covering up and your conscience keeps biting. At the end of it, your conscience wins and you become a mess. Therefore, give your conscience a rest and let it tell you what is right and what is wrong. What benefits you and harms someone is wrong. What benefits both is right. No question of the law. The law is unto yourself. So hard work and honesty are two very important, very indispensable ingredients for success. If you develop this system, you've made the journey from faith to fulfillment. And you will see that whatever measure you apply, you will be a successful person. And success doesn't mean coming on the headlines of the newspaper. Success may mean raising two nice children who make it big in life. Success can mean that your life made somebody else's life breathe easy. Success means you become an important person to many people in your environment. And success means having left a mark behind. Success may even mean building a small garden which others can enjoy after you're gone. So success is a very fluid term. It is not simply earning a lot of money. Today we talk of people, I don't wish to take names, but wealthy people, and say, oh, he's such a successful person. He is not successful. He itches the same way as a common man itches. He has the same problems in life. The more money he has, the more worries he has. He's got an uneasy life. And that uneasy life is covered by all the trappings of wealth, but inside not happy. Whereas a simple person has tremendous happiness. And that happiness shows in his face, in his demeanor, in his attitude to others. And that happiness is what you should quest for, and not the happiness of wealth. Because wealth is something that will disappear. Inner wealth is more important. So redefine wealth, children. Redefine wealth to health. Redefine wealth to character. Redefine wealth to personality. And that will be the wealth that takes you through your life. And you will be respected. You will be loved and respected. Whereas not detested as others who have a lot of money wealth. Therefore, go sometimes on your Google and check what is the definition of success in the language of Ralph Waldo Emerson. Emerson has written a beautiful poetic definition of success. And I don't have it handy, but I could read it out to you at some point. You can find it in Google. I don't want to spoon feed you everything, but read it. Read that Emerson's definition of success and let it become your motto in life. So with these few words, I have covered what I wanted to cover. When it comes to planning your time, I'll say one last tip. And when it comes to planning your time, it's very important that you make a to-do list. Every morning, you make a to-do list. And that to-do list is a list which you have to achieve on that day. So it has to be a realistic to-do list. It can't be, I'll build Rome by evening. It can't happen. You want to build Rome, say, I want 7 years to build Rome. After that, every day has a to-do list that takes you one step closer to the big goal. So you have a to-do list. You have to put it into four compartments. First, you write the whole to-do list. Initially, you have to write it. For the first month, you have to write it. After that, your habit will become such that in your mind only you'll write it, in the mind only you'll put in the compartment and you'll act accordingly. What are the four compartments you put your to-do list? First compartment is urgent and important. You write on top urgent and important. And in that, all the things of your to-do list which are urgent and important, write them in that box. The next box is urgent but not important. It's urgent to be done, but is not so important. So you put in the next box. The third box is important, but not urgent. So it's very important to be done. It has to be done, but it's not urgent. It can wait till the end of the day. And last is not urgent, not important. Something that gives you pleasure. The superfluous pleasure. Sometimes you don't need that box. But suppose you want to see a movie and there is an exam. And the someone is close related to you is unwell. Now you got a to-do list. I have to visit the unwell. I have to prepare for exam. I have to see a movie. You don't go and see the movie first. You say, I visit the unwell first. I finish it. Urgent and important. Because that person needs you. And you don't know. Unwell can become very badly unwell. And then you don't know what. So finish that first. Then you got exam. So it's urgent. Urgent and important, but number two, finish studying for your exam. After that, you have spare time left. And say, yes, now I can do my non-urgent, non-important, go and see the movie. and you've done everything perfectly, but you go and see the movie and then some calamity happens and you can't do number one and number two, and days wasted, you flunked the exam, your past is a series of regrets, your future is a series of worries, and today is wasted. So give today your best, plan your life with a to-do list. The to-do list should take you in line with your goal, and you're made for life. With these few words, I say, okay, I've said everything I want to. I don't know if I overshot the time. I lost track of time. Mahesh, am I in time?
Yes, sir. You are in time, sir.
So, Gandha, am I in time?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Okay, so now we can throw it open to discussion.
Yes, sir. Lost track of time completely listening to you. So
exactly.
I lost track of time completely too.
So yes,
the platform
is open for Q&A now.
Yes. I'll be happy to answer any questions, any comments, any experiences, anything. I'd like kids to share experiences with me. You want to start with the biggest kid? Amrita ma'am?
I only have one thing to say, that every time I listen to you, it's a lot of inspiration coming away. So definitely.
No, I was looking at all the faces and getting inspiration.
I want children to now trouble you with a set of questions.
I have all day to answer them. So shoot.
Atharv, you have a question?
Yep. You have?
Atharv, yes, has ma'am. A question.
Arthur, go ahead.
So thank you for your enlightening talk. It was very informative.
Thanks.
So you talked about individuality and the importance of setting goals.
Yeah.
So is there a specific time period with which, like, there's a limit with which we should be setting our goals? And also one more question, how do we ensure that our goals do not overlap with our family time? Because for some individuals, their goals might be something very materialistic in nature. So how do we ensure that that does not overlap?
That's when you make your to-do list, because your family time is part of that to-do list. So you set a goal, it's your personal goal, and once you set your goal, you do time budgeting. And in the time budgeting is the prioritizing, as I told you. In the prioritizing, your family, your passion, your health, everything needs some space. So you need that, okay, I have 24 hours, in that 8 hours I'll sleep, in that 1 hour I'll spend with mom and dad, I'll spend 1 hour on exercise, I'll play some nice game. So I'll play it to a point where I excel. And then I'll spend 6 hours on studies, and 3 hours will go on food and rest in the day, or food and other important things like bathing and brushing and self-care. So like this, you budget your whole day and then you got time for everything. But if you don't budget your whole day, you'll find you're sitting on the bench on the side and dreaming of that goal which you want, but not heading towards it. And dreaming doesn't get you anywhere. They say you must see dreams. Dreaming is like building castles in the air. They say must build castles on the air, but after that work to build the foundation underneath. Because a castle in the air without a foundation underneath is going to be blown away with the first gust. And gusts of wind are there in plenty in life. You know, life's gusts of wind are bigger than the cyclonic storms which we see. So get a strong foundation, for which there is time for everything if you plan your time.
So, and also the first part of the question where I
what
asked,
was it?
By when should I set a goal for my life?
You see, that depends on your own inspiration. Like, I'll tell you, in the 7th standard, I decided that the life depicted in those two novels is the life I want to lead. So I set myself the long-term goal in the 7th standard. And that long-term goal took me 5-6 years to get in. 5 years to get in. Because 7th to 11th, and then inter-science, and then getting into medical college. So at every stage, there were more goals, like getting in, going to classes, studying the right books, and getting the right tutions and X, Y, and Z. So as you address your passion, suppose your passion is, I'm just throwing a dart in the dark. Suppose your passion is that you want to become the opening batsman of India in world-class cricket. Then you should start building your body from now you should start studying the role of world-class cricketers all over the world. What are the attributes they had? How much they trained? Start getting up at 5 in the morning and training before school and after school. Plus, start studying well, because you can't be a cricketer all your life. You be a cricketer, and after a cricketer, you should be respected for your other attributes also. And so, you have many things to be planned then. So, you set yourself a long-term goal of being a world-class cricketer. So, you need physical, mental, emotional resilience to become that. And you start training in that direction. So, you start focusing on that as your main passion. And then you give time to the other things in order to supplement that passion. So you got a long-term goal fixed. Now on the way, you might find that cricket is not your passion. Football is your passion. 99% of the things you do for cricket are applicable in football also. Only the skill is different. So you can shift your goal, but fitness is still needed. Planning is still needed. Time is still needed. Fields are still needed. Air is still needed. So you have changed the... fine-tuned your focus. So don't be afraid to fine-tune your focus as life goes on. And you may start off by saying, I want to do science. Then you may say, I want to be an engineer. Then you want to say, I want to be a mechanical engineer. Then you say, I want to bridge build. And then you build the best bridge in the world. And then sit on your laurels. So you have fine-tuned all along the line. So that's how you don't set time because I say so. You set time according to how you feel. I want to be this much. But don't set goals of money, because that money goal keeps shifting. I tell you, I was your age. You know, when I started medicine, a bit older than you, I said, I want to earn 5,000 rupees in 1 month. That time, 5,000 rupees was a lot of money, because to give you a relationship, a cinema ticket downstairs, as a student, I could afford downstairs. Upstairs was 5 rupees. And downstairs was 2 rupees 50 paisa and 3 rupees 50 paisa. I don't know if you have ever seen a 50 paisa coin. But we had 25 paisa and 5 paisa and 1 paisa also. But when you know that 3 rupees 50 paisa is the movie ticket, then 5,000 rupees is a lot of money. My secretary took 450 rupees. Today she takes 15,000 rupees. So... that's the inflation over the years. I set myself a target to earn 5,000. It took 6 months to reach that target. As soon as I reach 5,000, I realize I have more bills to pay. I need more help in the office. So I need actually 10,000. So that goal shifted to 10,000. I said, when I earn 10,000, I'll celebrate. By the time I reached 9,500 and made it 10 and succeeded in keeping it 10 for 3 months, my realization told me that I need to have 20,000. So I still didn't smile. It became 20,000. I said, no, I need 25 to smile. I reached 25. I said, I need 50 to smile. I need 50. I reached 50. I reached 3 lakhs. I reached 10 lakhs. And now I realize that if I want to smile, I better smile now. It's not going to ever come otherwise. So don't keep money goals. Money will come. You see that you're comfortable. Give goals of something tangible, something where everybody benefits from what you have done. Money will come on the side. Be a millionaire of personality, of character, of health, of physique, of knowledge, of wisdom. Millionaire of money will come after that. Today, no millionaire without character is being worshipped. Before he is dead also, he stopped worshipping him. But you see those people who are made worship today, great people, they didn't have any concentration on money. So money is not all that important. Other questions?
Thank you so much, sir.
Thanks,
yes, Rushil, I think, has a question. Rushil, you've raised your hand. Your question, please.
Sir, do you think we should plan out a set of alternative goals just in case we fail to fulfill our primary goals? Or will that dilute our passion towards fulfilling our primary goal?
Say it again, Purva, right?
Rushil.
Roshan.
1 minute. Roshan, where have I lost you? Roshan, just repeat your question, please.
So should we plan out a set of alternative goals?
No.
Like if you have to fulfill.
Your plan B is success of plan A. If you set yourself plan A Have faith. This is what all faith is about. If you plan on failing, then let plan B become your plan A. But if you have faith in yourself, faith in your abilities, faith in your capacity to conquer, plan A will become a reality. So your plans up 1 to 10 are the same. And plan 11 and 12 are plans of failure. So there are no plan Bs. You make a plan. You may change your plan. You may change according to your passion changing. And your passion will change according to the exposure you have. The more you expose yourself, the more your passions will get realization. So it's very important at your age to read a wide variety of things, meet a wide variety of people to see how everyone's lives are shaping them. Till you come across that person who say, this is the life I want. Because you can't invent all that yourself. So read many things, read books, even seeing movies, see sensible movies. Don't see movies which are best forgotten before they started. So read, study the lives of successful people, read their lives, see how they went through, see what all they went through, read those words, read literature. And once you've done all that, you will see which life resonates with your life. Because inside you, there is a sound which you are not able to hear till someone resonates it. Once it resonates, it will become loud and clear. When it becomes loud and clear, then come hail or fair weather, you have to achieve it. And that for that, you have to, you go to my faith and full faith to fulfillment TED talk. I don't have time here to tell you that entire TED talk, but I had a problem in my life where I was told by everyone that I'll never succeed. And I thought also at some points, I gave up also many times, but I only woke up next morning to say, no, I won't give up. And now I can say it openly because I reached the position I wanted to. Otherwise, it would have been boasting about something I never achieved. And therefore, it's very important that you focus hard on what you have and don't let your focus waver on plan B, plan C, plan D. And keep each thing in its own compartment. Your family is in one compartment. Your children will be in one compartment. Your wife will be in one compartment. Let their compartments also flourish, but don't let your passion compartment sacrifice for the other compartments, because these are the things you were born for. You were born to do something. You have to only discover quickly what it is that you were born to do. Your life has a purpose. Find that purpose is your first primary mission and realize that purpose is your secondary mission. Other questions?
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Thanks. We have a question from Dhwani.
From?
Dhwani.
Dhwani. Oh.
Thank you, sir. Your speech was really motivational and I really love some of the points you made. In the beginning of the speech, you had mentioned about how we should all be searching for our passion and we should follow our passion. And once again, you answered Rushil's question by saying that passion changes according to exposure. So, sir, I would like to ask you that, a lot of students, including myself, it is very hard to think of one singular passion in our school life. And then you did mention that people who try out a lot of subjects in college kind of end up not focusing on one of them. But would it be so wrong to try out liberal arts and a lot of subjects in case you don't know what you're passionate? Wouldn't it actually increase your
Dhwani, I got your point. Liberal arts is something which is the refuge of those who wasted their whole school life. Because if you go to see, school life is liberal arts. In school, you can taste all the subjects, all the games, all the things, but many people don't realize this. And in school life, they don't capitalize on all those things. So then after that, when they get out into the world, then they say, now I want to experience all that. That is their postponing. I don't say liberal arts is a bad thing. If you miss the bus, it's better to take the second bus than not to board a bus at all. So when I tell children, do it now, like for example, you have 12th standard ahead of you still before you finish. Experience as much of it as you can now. Don't say this is not what I want or this is not what I... Unless you tried it, you can't reject it. But as you try more and more things, you will reject. And passion is like this. It's a full circle. big circle, this is your broad passion. Then you will find that the circle shrinks and shrinks till finally it becomes pinpoint where you can focus on your extreme passion, which you were actually born for. And that extreme passion will not be evident to you right away. So it's like me wanting to do medicine first, and after that choosing to do medicine as opposed to surgery and gynecology, and further going on to be a diabetologist in the field of medicine. And in life diabetology, I chose lifestyle to become a part of my super specialty. And in lifestyle, I started looking at stress as one of my best specialties. So I went zeroed in on what I enjoyed most. So first I did the entire thing and then shrunk and came to the point I enjoy most. It's not that I'll neglect my other field. Today, if someone with diabetes rings me up, I give them full advice. But that is my bread and butter. Stress management or to talk to children, give them a direction in life is the jam on my bread butter. And that jam is what I live for. So it's like when you do all these things, you try many, many things, you'll realize some things you enjoy and some things you can let go. So without trying to reject is prejudice. Never be prejudicial. Prejudicial. Don't make judgment without trying. So try first, then judge.
Ma'am, may I ask a question, please?
Yeah, sure.
Good afternoon, sir. Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. It's always a pleasure to listen to you. And in fact, I was just thinking recently how I would miss the camp because I attended it the previous two times and it's always been a very joyous little getaway. You
know, there may be a chance to do third time also.
I hope so. I certainly hope so.
Yeah, the box next to you is responsible for that.
Yes. All right, so now this is a very crucial and rather stressful time for us, sir. And, you know, being in the 12th grade, you're at this turn in your life where you're still not really sure as to what you want to pursue, as Dhwani rightly said. And I just want to ask, in this stressful time, how can we manage our stress? Because it becomes overbearing at times and, you know, many of us may not be properly equipped to deal with.
Yeah. See, the stress, no? Stress is good. Stress is the pressure exerted by the environment. I'm going to talk in physics language. The stress is the pressure exerted by the environment on a body. Okay? So, you have a rubber band. It's a small rubber band versus a big rubber band, a heavy-duty rubber band. Now, the heavy-duty rubber band can be used to keep six pencils together, but it can also keep an entire parcel together. You can put it around a larger thing and still it won't snap. But a thin, small one may be good enough to hold your plait. But when it comes to holding six pencils, you find that now it's becoming a little tight. And if you put the seventh pencil inside, it may snap. That is stress. You decide which one you want to be. You want to be the small rubber band or you want to be the heavy duty rubber band. So choosing is our prerogative. After you choose, then you don't have a right to cry. After you choose, I want to go to school. For every one girl that goes to school, there are three who sit at home. I may be wrong in my statistics, and I wish I am. I wish every girl goes to school, every boy goes to school, but it's not true. Take the broad perspective, is every one girl goes to school, three sit at home. So you're already one out of four. After that, you say in your class, you come first. Now in that one out of four, you become one out of 100 or 1 out of 400. So like that, as you zero in on your specialty, you will have to weather more and more storms. And you have to, that's when you summon faith as your stick to hold you through that storm. That the faith that I can bear through this storm, because nothing lasts forever. When the storm passes, I'll be the winner. If I get blown away, then I'm a loser. So never give yourself an auto suggestion that I'm a loser. Because when you say I'm wilting under stress, it means you're in your mind thought I'm the small rubber band. The poor me wilting under stress is the strong me that says, bring it on. Make my shoulders broad enough. I can handle it. let this also happen, let that also happen, let it happen, I'll handle it. And how will you handle it? You have the same 24 hours to handle it as other people have 24 hours not to do anything. You plan your life. Plan your life, prioritize things and just do them. Do them to the best of your ability and stop worrying whether you will pass or fail. Because if your best of your ability is actually exploited, you have to pass. There's no question of failing. Now, half the time we worry and therefore our capacity reduces to 10%. Because you have exam tomorrow, you sit and fret. You don't study. You fret. I don't know anything. I don't know anything. You phone a friend and want them also to say the same thing. So it feels like we are two in the boat. But two sinking in a boat, both die. So you have to decide that, okay, there's an exam. I have 3 hours. I'll study as best as I can. Focus 100%. Then you see tomorrow. Tomorrow the question that you feared most will not come. The question you know only comes. So what's the harm of sleeping the night knowing that what you want, what you know, will come tomorrow? That's called positive thinking. They say, I'm practical. I must prepare for the worst. Then study the things that you don't know. If you didn't study the things that you don't know, then don't imagine that they will come tomorrow. Because even some great guy, I don't know if the Bernard Shaw or someone said that 90% of the things I worried about never happened only. So you waste so much of your mental energy in worrying where it is fruitless. Who has seen tomorrow? Let tomorrow happen. Then we'll deal with it. I learned in medical college that whenever I write an exam, if I fret in the night of questions that will happen tomorrow, I waste the whole night staying awake. And when I say leave it to the exam, and when the question paper comes in front of you, you realize that 6 out of 7 questions you know very well, and the 7th question there's enough room to invent. And that's good enough. So you must depend on your wits where you don't know the knowledge. Your wits are as sharp. And your invention can become some completely out of the box thought. So never let go of yourself. You have faith in yourself and make that faith stronger and stronger. And if you need someone to lean on, take the most permanent person, that's God. Today you say that sounds very corny. But people I lean on are mother and father. God put them there because he couldn't be there everywhere. But you want direct head office, then develop a strong faith. And God is not that image which you worship. God is the voice inside your heart. That conscience, that spirit, that instinct, that intuition. Those are words which are used to describe God. But because weak people cannot imagine that instinct, they put an image. Have you ever studied Ganpati? Studied Ganpati. Do you know why he has such a fat stomach and such big ears and such a long nose? Is it the elephant's head put on the baby? Some supernatural power?
Or that's what I've seen in one of the movies.
No, is it a myth? And what is the purpose of that myth? And how can his fatso's vehicle be a rat, a mouse? How? Ever thought? No.
Yes, Ganpati, I believe is I would
have. Ganpati is the embodiment of wisdom. And wisdom is fat. It should be huge. And how do you gain it? You have to have a long nose where you shove your nose everywhere. Explore. That's how you get it. And you have ear, you hear everything. You have eyes, you see everything. So Ganpati's eyes, ears and nose are very long. But his mouth is hidden. Means he keep quiet. Don't talk. And all this wisdom is so light that it can travel on the back of a mouse. You got it? And this is how they taught the children in the olden days. But today we worship Ganpati without knowing anything. So if you develop that habit, use your ears, eyes and nose, keep on finding things, keep to yourself, don't open your mouth unless asked to. Don't waste your words. You will save so much energy and you will imbibe so much that you become wise and the Ganpati.
Very true, sir. Thank you so much.
All the best. Your Akanksha.
Yes, sir.
Akanksha, your royal family.
No, we're kind of descendants of the Nepalese Mallas dynasty.
Yeah, retired royal family.
You could say so, yes.
No, you're royal. That name sounds so good.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, who's next?
Binita Parekh.
Come on. Binita.
Question.
Binita.
Yeah. Good afternoon, sir. So, like, your speech was really great and inspiring. Like, the thought that you said about making to-do lists, that has been always been something that my mom has pushed me to do. And that really does give me a picture of how, what I plan for the day or for the months, weeks, years, and everything.
Yeah.
But, sir, I think I want to talk, I wanted to ask you something, as in, personally, I face this issue. I always overestimate my capabilities, and on my list I add like 5 things to do in a day, and then I end up only doing 3, and then that puts me back and like takes away my motivation.
No problem.
So,
there's,
sir,
no,
like,
problem in that.
How is one like should like overcome that?
You can never overestimate your capabilities. If you feel you put 5 things on the table, you have to then go on to do a to-do list analysis of urgent, important. I think that's where you don't do it. If you did that, then you do the urgent, important stuff first, and you won't fill up in between with unimportant and unurgent things, non-urgent things, which take away your time, and therefore you don't finish all 3 things. Suppose you have 5 things, you focus such that you will finish 5 things. And with a bit of practice, and with a little bit of delegation, as you grow bigger, as you have many people to help you, you start seeing some competent people. Because as the saying goes, when you go to succeed, you must carry 10 people with you to the point of success. So this journey won't be alone if you are carrying people with you. So delegate to people who are less skilled, but are capable of doing some things. Like if you have to go to the bank to deposit 5 checks, I'm giving you an example of my life, or read a chapter from a very important book. The visit to the bank I make sometimes so that I meet the banking people, I make some conversation with them, I keep in touch with reality, but I don't go every time. I send a peon to go there because for him that is a skilled job. And my job gets done. So in my to-do list is deposit 5 checks in the bank. And the next thing is give this job to someone. So it's tick marked in my paper. And I go and read what I need to read. And at the end of the day, all the things that I had written got done. Some with the help of others, some by myself. And some, if they're not done, then they add on to tomorrow's to-do list. And then tomorrow's to-do list should be more realistic considering that today's is added on to tomorrow.
Yes.
So you can have imaginary to-do list and enjoy that and do the realistic to-do list as long as you're giving each day your best. So don't worry if you don't finish 5 things. But if you did 3 things and gave you happiness and you achieved something big enough, great. And the other 2 can go to the next day. Your life is long. You can keep doing to-do lists and everything will ultimately get covered, or nothing will be covered. Depends how you lead your life. So don't worry of incomplete to-do lists. Your to-do lists are what gives you a lot of enjoyment, because when you're writing it, it gives you a feeling of importance. It makes you feel strong. It makes you feel empowered that I have done so many things and so systematically, instead of just, just drifting like leaves in autumn, in the autumn breeze. If you imagine, they are drifting left, right, center with no purpose. So you do your to-do list and continue to do 3 out of 5 things.
Okay,
you're doing very well.
Thank you, sir.
Namya, your question next.
Hi, sir. Thank you so much for your talk. It was inspirational.
I think you've come on my camp, isn't it?
Sorry?
You've come on the camp with me.
No, I haven't. I was planning
you
on
haven't?
Coming this year. But let's see what happens about that.
You start praying hard that things get better and we go.
Yes, sir.
I'm praying every day.
Yes, sir.
So, yeah, Namya, you had a question.
So in your talk, you mentioned that it's important to set a goal. Even if you change it later, we should have a goal right now. And so what if you had a goal for the longest time? And then you start reading somewhere or you start listening to opinions and you experience something different and you start doubting your goal and you feel like changing it. So what would your
change it.
Be on
change
that?
Change it. change it, because that is your passion that on that day. And see, if you have made your first goal with serious consideration, then your next goal will not be very far from the first one, because it has the same harmony inside you. And if you have, let's say you have taken up, give me an example of what you're saying. Have you ever experienced it? That you started off wanting to do something and finally landed up doing something else?
So, for example, if I've always wanted to explore mathematics as a subject.
Yeah.
And then I decide that I want to get into finance and community service.
Okay. So mathematics and finance is not very far away.
Right.
It is a related thing, and community service is a left brain business. So mathematics and finance are governed by your left brain, and community service is governed by your right brain.
Yeah.
Because it is something to do with passion, feelings, love, humanity, and all these, like art, painting, dance, drama, and all that comes from the right brain, because right. That's the softer virtues. So it's very good if you do it both, because you exercise both your brains then.
All right.
And you'll be multifocal. Multifocal means you can have multiple passions, but each passion will make the other passion more sharp. If you see any of these big lives, no, they are musicians, they are writers. See, Albert Schweitzer was a wonderful physician, surgeon. He was a German in the World War II time. And he was not only that, he was a writer. He did medicine. He took up surgery. He was a surgeon par excellence. He was a musician par excellence. And he used to, in summers, he used to give music concerts. And he took a boat once for a journey. And that journey took him down, 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 and right into Congo. And he reached Congo. Okay. He saw how much poverty there was. And he decided, this is what I want to do. And that comes to your social work.
Right.
Or community service. And he settled down there. He took broken bark and broken stumps of trees. And he made a shed. And he started practicing medicine there with zero infrastructure. He trained tribal people. And he trained them to become his assistants. And today in Congo, there stands an Albert Schweitzer Memorial Hospital, which is doing so much free work. And the same man also went to jail because he was considered to be a German spy, because Germany was going through so much difficult times in the World War with Hitler and all that. So he experienced that also. He did music also. He wrote also. He wrote his books also. He had multiple passions, and multiple passions means each passion makes your other passion sharper. So exercise every bit of your noodles, and you do as many things as you like, as long as you give each one your best, and each one done one at a time.
All right.
So it's wonderful to have multiple passions.
And when would you say it would be too late to make a
transition? Never too late. It's never too late. I know of a 90-year-old lady who went and did MA. Joined college, did MA, and died after I got her graduation certificate. The most touching story, but true. So there is never to. When I was in medical college, there was a man who was 70 years old, who was a fellow student, because he decided to do medicine after his wife died, and he got into medical college at 66, and he was senior to me. And he practiced till he was 80. He was in the hospital only as a pharmacology lecturer. And he had before that done business. Before that, he had done, in his young days, he had done BCom and many things. So there's no end to practicing passion. Your passion is at that moment. At that moment, if something is so passionately aroused inside you, just go and do it. And do it with the best of your this thing. No reserve, no holds barred, because it may take you much further. Your passion is like wind. If you oppose it, you don't achieve. If you go with it, it carries you to your destination. So just do it. That's it.
Thank you so much, sir.
Good, Damya. Wish you all the best. One day I see you in newspapers. Multi-passionate Namya.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
All the best.
We have a question from Tanish.
Yeah. Where are you, Tanishq? Next page. Yeah, Tanishq.
Tanishq, you raise your hand. Your question. Okay, we'll move on to Charu. Charu, your question.
Yeah, first of all, good afternoon, sir. And that was a very beautiful and mind-awakening session from your
Thank
side.
You.
And I'm really motivated after that. So you talked about the target plans and the to-do list. But whenever I make plans for the first 5 to 10 days, I'm very indulgent to do the same. And later, I see myself procrastinating and being inconsistent. So how do I combat that inconsistency?
You mean every day it happens or it happens once in a while?
Once in a while.
Means you set yourself to-do lists and then once in a while you find that you don't want to do that to-do list.
Yes.
Is that right?
It happens for 5 to 10 days. I find myself doing it diligently and then I find myself getting tired out of it. And
then you need to readdress your to-do list and do something that energizes you. Because if you continue to do all the same things every day, however interesting they may be on day one, on day five can become very mundane. So if you're, let's say, focused on studying for exams, then on a day-to-day basis, if you gave yourself 1 hour of entertainment or enjoyment or something different, your alarm clock, your winding key becomes so wound up that then it becomes difficult for you to unwind. So you have to strike a balance on your to-do list and not be dogmatic about the quality of the activities. All activities are good in their right perspective. So if you feel that after 5 days of hard work, on the sixth day, you have to see a movie or have to go to meet a friend for coffee, then that becomes urgent and important on that day. So then it rises in its stature because you need it that day. So something that is not urgent, not important on normal days may become urgent and important on another day. So you have to go by your inner instinct also. And your inner instinct will guide you that today I have to do this. Then just do it. Because then you come back and do the first things with more energy.
Thank you.
And it's not wrong to fail in your to-do list. There are people who don't make that list. And then you make the list and fail in it, it's perfectly all right. Next day you can make up. And even if you have used 300 days out of 365, I say your success rate is far better than average, because average wastes 300 out of 365. And 65 is then used for panic resort. And as a panic, they try and make up ground. So it's like run and you run to make up with to catch up with the sun, but it's sinking only to race around and come up behind you again. So that day is lost. So if you lose your days like that, you can't get them back. Then panic running doesn't help you to rectify. So what's gone is gone. The day you wake up, it's morning. So wake up now, make your to-do list, plan your life, move to a program, and then see how beautiful life is.
Thank you so much, sir, surely. I would follow.
Thank you, Charu. Life. All the best.
So we now have a question from Gaurav.
Yep.
Yes, sir. Sir, first of all, I would like to thank you for this session. It really changed my perception on a lot of things. So my question to you is that you said about following your passion regardless. And I would like to ask for people who are not very comfortable with doing that. You know, they think that they should have more security about their future. Is it fine to pursue a tried and tested, you know, occupation which other people follow?
Gaurav, tried and tested by somebody else. What is one man's meat is another man's poison. So what somebody else has gone into, you know, this false sense of security. I say false because it's not actually security. It is fritter away your life. If you have a passion inside you, which is ignited, then you follow it blindly. Means follow it with your eyes open, but follow it without looking left, right, center. if you have not ignited your passion, then you are in what is physics called Newton's first law of motion. You did physics?
Yes, sir.
You're not doing physics?
No, but I'm a commerce student.
No, you're a commerce student. I'll tell you physics first law of motion. Newton's first law of motion says that any body remains at rest or uniform rectilinear motion unless acted upon by an external force. So when you say, I want security, you're choosing to stay at rest, which means you don't have to struggle. You don't have to go into uncharted seas. You don't have to jump into the water and no effort because you're already joined a running wagon. And in the running wagon, you don't even have to wear a seatbelt. You just sleep. And that sleep will carry you to an unknown destination, which may not be where you want to go. And therefore, if you have a passion, remember, you have to go through storms. You'll have to go through effort. You'll have to work hard. You'll have to go through periods of insecurity. But when you reach that journey, you will say, wow, this is the journey I wanted to make. You know, there's a saying which I have written a book on quotations, which are not published yet. But in the last quotation I put over there is that the idea is not to arrive at your grave lipsticked, powdered, neat and clean, looking beautiful, but to come in torn, worn out, scarred, slashed and tired, come crashing in broadside into your grave. And when you land, you exclaim, wow, what a journey. And that's the philosophy I'd like to absorb in my life. And that's the philosophy I recommend you to absorb, that go through everything. If it's, don't go for security, because everything is secure. Your food, clothing and shelter are secure. After that, if you don't move ahead, then you have gone into complacency, which is inertia. And inertia is the one word description of Newton's first law of motion. So don't be a body at rest. Otherwise, your principle will come and be the external force that pushes you to move. So,
yes, sir.
Plan yourself well. Make yourself first, you address what is my passion. It will come if you think hard and then say, okay, I want to be this, and then no looking back.
Yes,
you
sir.
You may say that, okay, my daddy's business is a cushion to fall back on. I also did my daddy's business. You know, your autobiography should read like that. I achieved this. And I also did my daddy's business. That is, by the way, but not I only did my daddy's business. That's wrong. Because you can always do your passion as a hobby also and do your business as a chore. But do it. Don't let your passion go. That's it.
Yes, sir. I understand that. I would just like to justify why.
Very good.
It was because what parents generally do, at least Indian parents, is that when you're young, they really give you what you want. Like, they'll buy you a guitar and they'll buy you all these.
Gaurav, your voice is not coming clearly.
It's soft. Better.
Yeah, better.
I would like to justify my question.
Please.
It was because what Indian parents generally do is when you're young, they if you say that you want to play the guitar, they'll buy you one. If you want to play the piano, they'll buy you one. And they'll put
yeah.
But as you grow and you reach 9th grade, 10th grade, they say that life is much more serious, and they make you think that, okay, you need to focus your studies more now, which I understand and I do.
Yeah.
They want you to have this sense of security, you know, by studying.
No, because they're well-meaning. They're well-meaning in the sense they don't want their child to suffer.
Yes, sir.
But unless you suffer, you don't grow. So you look, people say music is pastime. That's what your sentence meant. That yes. Music is pastime. Guitar and all that is for rock stars. They're for dropouts. But if you see Brij Bhushan Kabra, who's a world-renowned musician, he was a guitarist. You see A.R. Rahman, musician, world-famous, India's pride, A.R. Rahman, musician. Now, more than musician, he's a cranky musician, not musician, cranky musician. His working hours are 11 o'clock till 5 o'clock in the night. So people do recording at 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning when the world sleeps. But that's him. You see, his music is what the people get in raptures when they listen to his music. So if music is your passion, follow it. others may not understand it. The insecurities of a parent to give advice to their child is based on their incomplete knowledge of life. So they are also floating in their own lives. So they just want that, okay, my son should not be insecure. Therefore, he must have a BCom. And if he's got a BCom, he get a government job. And if he's got a government job, he's fixed. That is their level of ambition. You know, you dissect the word ambition, it comes from the word ambit. Ambit means periphery. Ambit means your Lakshman Rekha. And when you say I'm ambitious, it means I want to break my Lakshman Rekha. I want to go beyond. I want to spread my perimeter. Otherwise, you get restricted. You start with a small thing like that. But if you decide that, no, I'm ambitious, then you make that this big. Then you make this big. Then you make this big. So don't restrain your ambition. You can do both. You can study and get good marks, and you can play music also. If you give up something else, then you have to give up time pass. So plan your life where you can do both. Don't sacrifice passion. And reason, when you talk with parents, reason. You must have your answers also. You can't just say, I want. Then the question is, why I want? Then if that answer satisfies them, they'll take it. When I wanted medicine, I told my dad I wanted medicine. He said, no, this is his figment. How will he go and do medicine? Who will go to him? How will he pass? I had weak vision. So he said, how will you read the books? I said, I want. And when he realized that this guy actually wants, then he said, okay, I'll get you. I'll help you to get it. So dads always want that the child gets the best. But he should be sure that he's got a passion. If he's just thinking of wasting time, if you tell him, Dad, I got a rock band going every evening, we smoke pot and drink alcohol every day, that then he's going to be a very insecure man. He's going to beat the hell out of you and say, go to BCom and sit in my business. So don't do what they'll give them insecurity.
Yes.
Discuss with them. Yeah. Good. You got your answer, Gaurav?
Yes, sir, I did. Thank you.
Great. Thanks and all the best.
So the last question for today we have is from Tanisha. I know she's been waiting for a long time. So Tanisha, here you go.
Come, Tanisha. Where are you?
Good afternoon, sir. I really like the fact that you are telling us not to procrastinate, which is perfect. Firstly, we need to acknowledge the fact that we all come from a very privileged background, and associating success with materialistic things doesn't fit right with me at this point. So going to my question, sometimes I feel like that taking a break for my mental space is a good thing.
It is.
And if I do that, and I, for my parents, that is time pass because I'm not doing anything. I'm just doing something which makes me feel happy.
That's very important.
So if something like that is considered time pass because I'm not writing anything
You're not doing time pass. You're investing time. At that time, you're investing time. If you're doing time pass every single day of your life, then that is waste of time. But what is considered as time pass are pleasurable activities. And pleasure is a very important part to balance pain. For example, if you want to study to be a scientist, you'll have to study. And when the time you're studying is not the most pleasurable time. If you were given that there's no exam, read whatever you like, whenever you like, then it's fun. Because then you say, just now I'm inspired by magnetism. I'll read about magnetism. Then suddenly you feel, forget magnetism. I want to go and read about gravity. Then you read about gravity. Then you say, forget that. I want to read about tides, time and tide. I'll read that. So no one holding you in place. But if you have an exam on magnetism tomorrow, then you have held in place. And that's what is torture. But then you have to go through that torture, conquer it and move forward. But if you have exam today, exam tomorrow, exam day after, exam till Friday, Monday to Friday exams, and you focused, now you become so tight in the head that you want to unwind. Because if you unwind only, can you wind up again? So when you unwind, it is investing time. It's not wasting time. They sound the same, wasting and investing. Investing. So when you see a movie on a Sunday, after you have worked hard the 6 days, then you are actually doing a very good thing. But you must decide how you spend that relaxation time in actually relaxing. If you don't actually relax, then you have wasted that time. So if you're going to see a film, if you really wanted to see a nice film, then okay. But if you're going to see some absolute junk, just because you want to go and eat popcorn in the interval, then it's a waste of time. Then you might as well buy popcorn and eat it at home. But if you have a full week's program, in your full week's program, the important, the unimportant and the non-urgent also has a place, because that feeds your soul. And when you feed the soul gets more energy. Then next day you're ready to charge in through your troubled times with extra energy, knowing that at the end of the rainbow, there's a pot of gold.
So can I say something else? Am I allowed?
Yeah.
So also, sir, in liberal arts, we have arithmetic and geometry as well.
Yes.
So, I mean, I don't see the point, like if you take liberal arts, that doesn't mean you want to, like, you know, focus on all the aspects. It also means you have one focus.
You can.
I don't think that people who take liberal arts are not focused. No. They are very focused and they know what they're doing with this.
Some of them are very focused. All are not.
Most of them, sir.
Because most of them have taken it as a refuge to postpone decision by 2 years. I have asked so many students.
All me and my friends, I would say my surroundings, we have taken it as like we have one focus. And that's why we have taken it. So that's
very good. Statement. You can combine the subjects which you think can join up together. When you join the dots, the picture will be beautiful. That's the important thing.
Thank you for acknowledging.
You see, what is his name? Apple guy. Who's the inventor of Apple? Steve Jobs. When you read his education was a big major flop. He got into college because he needed a room to stay. And then he was thrown out. He said, I have to enroll for some class or the other to be able to stay there. So he used to walk miles to the Hare Ram Hare Krishna temple to eat a free meal because he didn't have the money to earn that. He joined a calligraphy class and he learned calligraphy. And then he joined some other class and he learned that. And then one day when he found his inner passion in the garage with a friend with a box computer, he decided to make the computer more attractive. So he made the font in calligraphy. And that's how the whole Apple explosion started, that it became a joy to behold because the presentation was so beautiful. And that presentation was his brainchild. And the reason was that he learned calligraphy in those days. And he did all those things that he did. So when he himself says it, you know, in one of his, he gives a graduation speech in Stanford. And he says it there, that when I was being educated, I didn't see any connection in what I was doing. But one day when I connected the dots, I found that my knowledge of that experience was helping me for this experience. So as long as you have a broad goal in your mind, do whatever. I'm not critical about liberal arts. I'm critical about people doing liberal arts to postpone big decisions. Your liberal arts is a very good subject, good opportunity. I wish I had it. I would have learned all the subjects and added them to medicine because my focus was medicine. So I am practicing liberal arts today. I read literature, history, geography, politics, everything today, which I could have done in my school days. But in my school days, no one guided me. So you are doing it with focus. Go right ahead.
Thank you very much.
Key word is focus. Whatever you're doing. Good, darling. You got your answers? Are there any more, Sugandha?
No, sir.
No? So we're done for the morning?
I think we've had a very enriching and insightful session.
I have still no idea what the time is. So
we are
it's 12:51.
Yes.
Oh, we have overshot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And on behalf of the students, Dr. Kokani, thank you so much. Because
it's been a pleasure right through and through.
We were all learning. You know, every time I listen to you, I feel that there's always a takeaway, which is something fresh and new. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for giving me this opportunity. And thanks to all the children for being such a lovely audience.
Thank you, sir.
Done?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Wish you all the best.
You too, sir. Take care.
Bye-bye. All the best. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, all of you. Bye.
Thank you very much.
Bye. Thank you.